at last, and did my Savior bled, and did my Sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for such a worm as I? Well, might the sun go down and shut its glories in when Christ, the mighty maker, died for man, the creature's sin? At the cross, where I first saw the light and the burdens of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight. And now, I don't care what it looked like. Right now, I don't care who's throwing rocks at me. Right now, it doesn't matter what type of tactics the devil has against me. Right now, my spirit is happy all the day.
Glory to God. Glory, glory.
1 Timothy chapter 2. Giving honor to God, our Father, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit. One that keeps us and seals us to the day of redemption. All of our leadership staff here at the New Bethel Baptist Church, Mama B, it's always special when she's in the house. All of our Father's children this morning, honor you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. In the second chapter of 1 Timothy, I'm reading from the original King James Version of God's Holy Writing. Just going to read two of the verses there, verse 5 and verse 6. Some preachers would say a very familiar passage of Scripture. I don't think any of it is too familiar when you don't understand it, when you're just reading words. The fifth verse says, "For there is one God, comma, and one mediator between God and men, comma, the man, Christ Jesus, semicolon." Verse 6 says, "Who gave himself a ransom for all, comma, to be testified in due time," period. You may be seated. We purposely added the punctuation because oftentimes we run on with the word of God, and when we don't punctuate, we miss the point. The point was put there to show emphasis of the things that was just stated before that point in time. Mm-hmm. How many mediators do you have? That's what we'll call this. How many mediators do you have? Do you seriously have someone that will defend you in good and bad? Thinking that really, this person really loves me and they really care about me and they'll stand with me through thick and thin, the old saying goes. And when it gets really thick, will they thin out? How many of us really have someone that will seriously stand on our behalf? I watched something that happened here in the prayer line just a moment ago. And sometimes things just excite me and it just stirs my spirit and just lifts me up. Mm-hmm. I watched as a young man in this church today, been here on several occasions with his mom, but he's here today with just himself and his child.
All right.
Standing there in the prayer line, the baby getting a little irritated, and a sister took her time to pet his hand and pet the young man and try to get everybody stirred, calm down, to so we could all share in the prayer together. And it just blessed my heart. Brother Anthony, God bless you. Good to have you with us today. It's amazing the way that things happen, because she was being kind of a mediator. Something needed to happen at that time. See, a mediator sometimes is not just a person that will stand up for you. It's a person that will give themselves for you. Give of themselves for you. The year was 1193. And a king was captured by, down in Australia, coming from the Holy Land, the English king called King Richard the First, or some might know him better as King Lionheart. King Richard the First had been down and sharing in the Holy Land, looking at the things that were happening, praying, I'm sure, and just enjoying teachings about this man, Jesus Christ. But coming from the Holy Land, he was captured there in Australia. And when he was captured, there was a ransom sent out, a ransom notice. How many of us, if someone captured us and a ransom notice was put out and say, look, you pay this, or I'm going to start plucking off arms, toes, and fingers until you pay it up. Will they do whatever it takes to get that paid to that person so that you could be free? Well, this king was captured, and the people loved their king. He was a person that seemed to love the Lord, treated the people well, so people actually went into their own sections and began to give donations, because 150,000 marks was asked for the king's ransom. No one had that type of money at that time. That was the equivalent of 3 tons of silver. That's a lot of silver. So the people started sharing, started giving. What else do we have to do? They went under some strict tax laws, and they began to tax the people, and the people were happy to share and pay these taxes because they wanted their king to be free. And then finally, one day, they reached the 3 tons of silver in equivalents and gave it over to Leonard V. When they gave the silver over, he released their king to come back to them. Now, I'm sure the people were just rejoicing at that time, because this man had been free. But do you know who was more happy to be free than the people that prayed and gave so that he could be free? The man himself. See, what we're talking about here is sometimes we just don't grasp what is going on inside of the scriptures. Yes. This chapter started out and it ends on a note where people would be just walking around mad. Because in this chapter, it told people's roles in the church. And people don't like you to tell what my role is. Let's go to another scripture. Let's just deal with the first part of that chapter, because Paul lost his mind at the end there when he said that the man is the head. Now, you're talking about in the church now. Sometimes at the house, man. They're supposed to be at the house, too. But in that chapter, he spelled it out, and people was like, Paul couldn't have been talking about that day and time. This day and time. He was only talking about that day and time and that for that particular church because this thing was happening that. Wait a minute. And then the next day you see me, you'll say it's a word for all season. Amen. Amen. We pick and choose with the word of God, but the word of God is not structured like this. So this chapter started out with prayer. And it got right up in our grill because if we don't like somebody, sometimes we just won't pray for them. This told us, this was talking about public prayer, and it was talking about praying for everybody.
Yes.
It was talking about really offering up supplication.
Yes.
Praying for everyone. Mm-hmm. And Paul wrote this, and he said, even pray for the kings, mm-hmm. the emperors, the people that were in power. The person that was in the most power at that time was Caesar Nero. He would be the one to demand the head of the Apostle Paul, but Paul said, pray for him. I didn't vote for some of the people that were president. I didn't like some of the things that they did. But do you know what you and I are supposed to do no matter what? I'm not supposed to talk against that person. I'm supposed to pray for them.
Amen. Amen.
Paul prayed for them and he taught the people there. He told Tim, he said, look at Tim. You pray for those that are in authority, those that are in leadership position, those, no matter what, from the poor house to the rich house. You pray for every one of them. And he was teaching him. He said, you have this mandate. This mandate coming from my mouth, but coming through the Holy Spirit to you. You pray for everybody. You pray for them whether you like them or not. Whether they dress the way you like or not. You pray for those people right there. Because if you start praying for people, I've been telling y'all this a long time. You start praying for people, you can't really hate somebody you're praying for. After a while, you'll start loving and caring about that person. After a while, you'll start looking at that person different while you're praying for them. While you can't stand that person, you start praying for them. And after a while, you'll see what in the world was I mad at them about anyway? Something will change inside you and I.
All right.
But that is you being a mediator. You are being somewhat of a mediator. And we don't want to miss the point here, but we'll get down to the scripture now, what we're talking about today. In that fifth verse, it says that, for there is one God. Now, the Apostle Paul said this to Timothy. He wanted Tim to understand that. Do you think Timothy didn't know that already? So, Paul, why are you telling me this? Why you keep telling me the same thing all the time, Paul? Why does this have to continuously be put in the scripture? Why? Because Peter said, I will not be negligent to remind you constantly of the things that are written here in the Word of God. You need to be reminded of these things. Yes, you know some of these things. But sometimes you need a refresher course.
Yeah.
See, the thought there is one God and you're not him. That's what the comma said. You see that comma at the end of that? That's what the comma says. It said, he is God and I can't be God. My heart just don't work the same way. I found out that God, it never failed. There in the 13th chapter of 1 Corinthians verse 8. His love never fails.
Yeah.
But my love, sometimes it might fail you.
Yeah. Yeah.
It might leave you standing out there in the cold. But God's love never, never, never fails. He never fails. He is always going to be God. He is always going to be holy. He's always going to do the right thing for you and me. He's always going to be working on behalf of those that love him. He is always going to be God. Do we understand the magnificence of our God? When we we say the word God, even the ancients, they didn't want to even say his name. They kind of went around it because they didn't think that their mouths were worthy to even say the name of God. They didn't want to say Yahweh or Jehovah. They didn't want to say it like that. They wanted to say it in a different way, to always give honor to God. But he broke down the middle wall and he said, now because of that next person, you can call me God. You can come into my presence. And he is God. He's God. He's going to always be God. And then our next point, we get moving right along here today. There is one mediator between God and men. Come on. Y'all see that? There is one mediator between God and men. Comma means you're not him. And I'm not him. I can be a little Christ. I can help people in different types of ways. I can try to stand in the gap for people. I can pray intercessory prayer. I can try. But all of these things only work because we have one mediator between God and man. A mediator, a defense attorney, Job said it like this in the 9th chapter of Job. I wish that was a day's man. I wish that was someone that could touch the hand of God and touch my hand and bring us together. It needs to be somebody between me and God, because when I start talking to God, I realize that I'm not worthy. There needs to be a day's man. Said there is one mediator. Mediator. A person that could stand between. A person that could give it all. A person that is worthy to handle that. A person that can stand between me and God. There are many people that want to go to God, but they don't want to go through a mediator. Anytime a Christian, a true believer, prays, do you realize that our prayer has to go through the mediator? Do you realize that the only reason we can talk to God is because there's someone that is connecting the lines? Whenever we pray, if you don't have your service paid to the phone company, they cut you off. But you and I can go to them because we have a line that has been connected. And the good thing about our connection is that it is through a line that's not hampered by the storm. As a matter of fact, it almost seems like it's even better service when the storm comes on. Because it's something that happens within us. We cry out louder when there's storms raging in our life. And when God's children go to crying, God goes to respond. It was Peter. He was standing out there on the sea. He had walked out and stepped out of the boat and said, Lord, if it's you, bid me to come to you. And he stepped out of the boat and he began walking toward Jesus. But something happened along the way and he took his eyes off of Jesus and he began to sink into the water. And he, at that time, as he was going down into the water, he didn't stop to pray a long prayer. He didn't stop to say, look here, I need some help here. Now, I need my service connected because I don't have that right then. He said, Lord, save me. It didn't take all the ceremonial type stuff, because the person that connects the line was the person standing in front of him. And he reached down and he pulled him up out of the water and set him back in the boat. Well, a lot of other fellas wish they would have walked out too. Maybe. A dazed man.
All right.
A dazed man. See, there was a time when someone else had to actually perform a ritual to keep the line open between God and men. See, this happened even after the time of Job, because Job didn't understand the sacrificial system. Job never talked about Moses, because Moses was after Job. Job never talked about the law, because the law came after brother Job. It came way after. But in that sacrificial system, that was something that was set up, and we can read it thoroughly there in the 16th chapter of Leviticus. In the 16th chapter of Leviticus, God had set forth a system to get the people right with him. And it only lasted for 1 year, but it did last. It did work. It was something that was working. It was working just fine until another man came on the scene. But in that 16th chapter, Aaron, the brother of Moses, he was the high priest at that time, and he would go into the Holy of Holies. He would go in there the first time with the blood of the scapegoat. You thought that was a word we came up with, didn't you? And you don't even understand it if you're thinking like that. The scapegoat was one of two goats. The first time he went in with the blood of a bullock, but the second time he went in with the blood of the scapegoat. One of the goats, they would cast lots, however shooting dice, whatever, however they did it, they chose which goat was going to die. And when they chose which goat was going to die, they would kill that goat and offer that goat blood to be taken into the Holy of Holies by Aaron. Now, he's already been in the Holy of Holies one time that day with the blood of a bullock for himself and his own family. That was to keep him pure and worthy and ready. So he would go in and he'd come back out and he would get the blood of the scapegoat. And the blood of the scapegoat, the goat that died, he would take it in to the Holy of Holies. And he would sprinkle that blood on the mercy seat, that box that was there, which the Ark of the Covenant, that the top of that was a lid called the mercy seat. Inside of the box was the rod of Aaron that budded, a little manna up in there, and the Ten Commandments, the stone tablets inside of that box. And when he would go in, he would shake that blood up on that mercy seat. And when he came out, he would take some of that blood if he came out. Say, if he came out. Because if he went in there and he wasn't holy, he didn't come out on his own. He went in with a rope tied to him. And if he didn't, if that bell didn't keep ringing, they just drug his dead behind on out of there. Because he wasn't worthy to go into the Holy of Holies. Now we're trying to set it up. We're trying to help you understand that mediator. Now, he would be somewhat of a mediator, because he could die performing this service. And he would go in there and he sprinkle that blood, and then he would come out and he would put that blood on the head of the other goat. Remember, we said it was two goats. He would put the blood on the head of the other goat. And that blood was put there representing the sins of the people. Now that goat has something to do himself. See, we had one person that did this job totally and completely by himself. But this goat, he actually was taken out, the Bible says in the 16th chapter of Leviticus, by a fit man. I don't know what that means. It might have meant he had muscles bulging everywhere. It may have been he just knew how to run real good. But that man was fit for the job. But he was to take that goat and see that goat away from the people. Now, the historians of that came down through the years said that as that goat would get farther away,
All right. They
would radio back. Not radio like we radio. We got cellular phones. And we just call somebody and say, he gone now. But they would tell, he's gone a little bit farther now. And somebody else would relay that message. And the message would just keep going back. The message would just keep going back until it got back to the people. And then finally they get that message that they want to hear. He's gone out of sight. I can't see him anymore. And that represented the sins of the people had left and were gone now for one whole year. The sins of the people were gone. But the Bible tells us that we have a greater. That one that took his own blood into the Holy of Holies. And put his own blood on the mercy seat for you and I. He didn't have to have another goat to take the sins away. As a matter of fact, the Bible said that he died for us. Went down into the grave. Carried our sin far away from us. All that would just trust the fact that he did it for us. He took those sins far away from us. Never to come to us again. That's the problem that we have. We like these things to come back on that person. They've confessed it. They've given it to the Lord. They've moved on. But we want to bring it back on them. Thank God, God is not us. We not God. That was the point that Paul was making that attempt. Because if we look at this thing the way that we look at it, we'll be messed up. But when that goat was gone, those people's sins were gone. But Jesus, when he died, he carried our sins and buried them in a grave. He didn't get up on the third day morning with your sins in his hand. He said, all power, heaven and earth has been given unto me. I don't have your sins with me. They've been taken care of. They were nailed there to the cross. And I died there on the cross. Paul said that those things are dead. They're gone away from you and I. We don't have to deal with those anymore.
My Lord.
One mediator. It was Jesus that took his own blood in. That's why he can mediate. But it seems like we don't have enough there, does it? Seems like we stopped just before we got to the end there. Because it seemed like it got to be some more. Paul, Tim sitting there listening to Paul. But come on now. I understand the sacrificial system. I know what happened there in the 16th chapter of Leviticus. I understand that part. But what else, Paul? Come on, Paul. Tell me. Okay. The man, Christ Jesus. Period. Right, go ahead, semicolon. The man. Wait a minute. Wasn't he God? Yes. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was God at that time. Yes, he was God. In the beginning, God created heaven and earth. He was there in the beginning. All things were made by him. John said, and without him was not anything made that was made. Him. He was God. But Paul, you said he's a man. Yes. Because if he was just God, he couldn't have done that for you. God so loved the world, but love won't save you, and love won't save me. What are you talking about, preacher? God so loved the world. Well, that scripture didn't even stop there. He said he so loved the world that he gave. You love somebody, give. You love somebody and care enough about them, you go do what it takes to get the 3 tons of silver to pay the ransom.
Yes.
You said you want them free. You said you want them there in heaven with you one day. See, that's the problem that we have sometimes. We want God to step out of being God and do something that's not godly. There was only one way to pay the sin debt that you and I have. I'm almost in it now, y'all. There was only one way to pay the sin debt. And that was through the precious blood of
of Jesus Christ. God so loved that he gave his only begotten son that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. He gave his son to die. A man that came down through generation after generation. David said he is after me, but he was before me. That man, the Bible said that person that was slain before the foundation of the world, Jesus Christ, he had to become a man, born of a woman, with flesh just like you and I. To conquer sin in the flesh. See, all the flesh ever knew was to sin. We look directly into the law of God, and when we look at the law, we say, wait a minute now. I hadn't been able to keep this thing totally and completely. We can go and write one of the Ten Commandments down, and we can stamp that thing to the refrigerator, to our computer at work. We can say, I will not commit this sin right here. But James said that if you're guilty of one, you're guilty of every one of them. Wait a minute now. Don't be calling me no covetous now.
All right.
But you killed. Well, I ain't killed nobody. Was you angry with them without a cause? The Bible said if you're angry with your brother without a cause, you're guilty of murder. You're trying to wrap it up like you want to wrap it. But there was only one person that lived a sinless life. He was a man. But he was all God also. At the same time, Jesus Christ was that man. And why did he come? Verse 6 says that. Who gave himself a ransom. Well, who asked for a ransom? You and I were sold out under sin. We were slaves to sin. We were given over to sin. We could not even walk away from sin because sin is in our nature. Look at the people of the world. They don't care nothing about sin. We sit here and fuss about them taking prayer out of school. The world didn't put prayer into school. They don't care nothing about prayer. You teach that baby how to pray and they'll walk into school with prayer. That's the way you handle that. Prayer ain't never came out of school for those that know how to pray. Those that teach our children at home. I'm trying to help you understand. So we have someone that paid the ransom. It was that day on Calvary. Somebody had to stand the ground for me. Because when I look at the law, there's nothing wrong with the law. The law is perfect. The law has always been perfect. God gave the law. A holy God, a perfect God, gave the law. The law will always be perfect, but I'm imperfect. Even now, sometimes Satan gets on my track, and sometimes I don't do the right thing. But the law was always perfect, and it'll always be perfect. God is the orchestrator of the law, but there is one that obeyed the law.
Yes,
Lord. Totally and completely.
Yes,
he did.
Yes,
he did. And he was obedient to his father.
Yes.
His father had given him instructions.
Yes,
he was obedient even to the point to where he would die on the cross.
Yes.
Carrying an old rugged cross up a hill.
Yes.
Laying down and having that cross nailed to him.
Yes.
Lifted up in the air. Going back to what the reason that he said, the things that he said would happen to him. He said that if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. That was talking about things in two different ways. How do you lift up Jesus? Do you lift him up? Do you just talk about him being hung on the cross and nailed to the cross? Or do you teach somebody about Jesus? Do you teach them that through him being lifted up on the cross, he can save you from your sins? He'll take your sins far away, just like the scapegoat did. He'll take those sins away, not to come back next year, but to be gone forever and ever, never to come upon you again. Your sins are completely gone. Matter of fact, God said, for my own sake, will I remember your sins no more. Because of what my son did there at Calvary Cross. Jesus died there on the cross. Don't you be confused about it. I realize there are some that say that he didn't really die. He was just in a subconscious state at that time, and he wasn't breathing like the rest of us breathe. But my Bible tells me that Jesus died there on the cross. My Bible tells me that he died for me. My Bible tells me that he died for you. He died until the moon went down in blood, until the sun refused to shine. My Savior died. He gave it all up for me. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him, if you just believe, trust the fact that he did it for you, he'll save you totally and completely. It's a good thing that he died, but my Bible let me know that he could have died right there. I could have trusted that and been dead and in a grave, but saved. But early Sunday morning, my Lord, my Savior, got up from the grave.